Live from your public media studios, WVIA presents Keystone Edition Reports, a public affairs program that goes beyond the headlines to address issues in northeastern and central Pennsylvania. This is Keystone Edition Reports. And now, moderator Larry Voitko.
53 years ago, that's the last time northeastern Pennsylvania saw rail service between Scranton and New York City. But that is about to change. Recently, just last December, Pennsylvania Senator Bob Casey and Congressman Matt Cartwright, along with the Federal Railroad Administration, announced that rail service between the cities will no longer be a thing of the past, but rather be part of the region's future. Now, there's plenty of work to be done before we can all board that train in 2028. Track improvements need to be made, stations need to be constructed, and then there is the acquisition of the trains themselves. The project promises to benefit hundreds of thousands of people. There'll be stops in Stroudsburg and Mount Pocono, as well as several communities in New Jersey. So how will this benefit our region? Well, according to a recent Amtrak study, direct rail service between Scranton and New York could generate up to $84 million in economic activity each year. Will there be opportunities for area workers who want to find jobs in New York City? And what about increased tourism dollars for our area? Many questions remain to be answered, but one thing is a certainty. Come 2028, the Electric City and the Big Apple will once again be linked via train service. Keystone Edition Reports' Tom Reese takes a closer look.
Up to 110 miles per hour, three times a day. That's the proposed schedule for Amtrak service between the Electric City and the Big Apple, and it could be up and running as early as 2028. The last passenger train service from Scranton to New York City ended in 1970, and talk of reviving the service has been ongoing for more than 40 years. That talk has now given way to reality. The trip is estimated to take just under 3 hours, and may just open up a world of possibilities for those who would utilize the service. According to Amtrak, there are about 500,000 potential riders in the region who would be linked to 500 cities in the Amtrak network. Area officials have dubbed it a game changer for the region, broadening employment opportunities, bringing tourism dollars, keeping friends and families closer, and having easier access to an arts and culture hub. Residents could also access a wider range of healthcare services. It's an exciting time for the region, as what's old will be new again. Myriad possibilities will abound, and the area's past and future will come full circle. For Keystone Edition Reports, I'm Tom Reese.
Thanks so much, Tom. Well, let's welcome our guests who are here to share their expertise on the topic. And joining us here in the studio, Paige Cognetti, the mayor of the city of Scranton. Larry Malski, president of the Pennsylvania Northeast Regional Railroad Authority. And Mr. Mike Carroll, Pennsylvania Secretary of Transportation, and joining us via Zoom, Congressman Matt Cartwright, representing the 8th Congressional District of Pennsylvania. Well, welcome so much. Welcome to you to be here. And welcome to those of you joining us through our live streams on Facebook and YouTube tonight. And remember, we'll be answering your questions and comments in our special Q&A after the show that ends at 7:30. So stick around on Facebook and YouTube. And we have guests in the Sardoni studio here. So to those of you, if you have a comment or question, there's a microphone in the aisle. Simply rise and go to the microphone, and I will know that you are ready with your question. I'll then throw it to you at an appropriate time. But let's dive into it. Those of us who are natives of northeastern Pennsylvania have heard about this renewal of train service for literally decades. And, you know, we've been looking forward to that connection between Scranton and New York City for that. But nothing ever materialized. So, Larry Malski, will this time be different?
Well, that's the most asked question that I've gotten and we've all gotten. And I've really brought the answer down to a very simple response, and that is the reason this time it's going to work is $66 billion. We've never had that commitment in federal funding. And because of the bipartisan infrastructure bill that Congressman Cartwright, Senator Casey, and the President put forth and on a bipartisan basis was passed by the entire Congress, we've got a real realistic funding, federal funding stream that we never had in 40 years. Mm-hmm. And that was actually the missing ingredient.
Mm-hmm. Do you agree, Secretary Carroll?
Completely. We wouldn't be having this conversation if it were not for the passage of that bill. Mm-hmm. It's just that simple. So, and that passage combined with the wonderful work that Larry and his team have done through the years really gives us a wonderful opportunity for success.
Larry, back to you. What is this work that Secretary Carroll just referred to over the years? What have you been doing over the years?
Well, for the last 40 years, when we first organized the rail authorities, these rail lines that we're going to operate over were actually being abandoned and in some cases ripped up. So we had a little work to do. We didn't own them. We had to go forth and purchase these lines. And, you know, many people back then said, what are you doing this for? I mean, this is maybe not a good use of taxpayer money or anybody's money because the private railroads abandoned them. Well, the simple fact is, once you give up these rail corridors, you're giving up at a tremendous economic development foundation that in many cases is almost impossible to put back. We were fortunate in Pennsylvania to save the entire portion of this rail route in Pennsylvania from Scranton to the Delaware Water Gap. And quite honestly, it took a long time.
Mm-hmm. One of the differences, too, in this cutoff, as I understand, is that this is not shared rail between passenger service and freight service. Is that correct?
It's a critical difference. The fact that the track is publicly owned from Scranton to New York City makes a huge difference. To negotiate with a Class I railroad, Norfolk Southern or CSX, for example, would make this proposition much more complicated. Kudos to Larry and his team for making sure that that trackage was secured. Monroe and Lackawanna counties deserve tons of credit for that. And then as you progress into New Jersey Transit has control of the track there. So a huge advantage for this project.
And if I may, let me just interject. The 60 miles that we saved, we actually ironically run freight and passenger service on it right now. Our freight operator has a contract with us, so that's with the authority. We're the owner, and they service the industries. And it just very quickly, you know, we brought 15 new industries into the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania on this abandoned portion of the rail line after we bought it and rebuilt it. So it shows you the economic benefit. And the passenger service is the excursions that we run for this National Park Service, Steamtown National Historic Site. So we actually have freight and passenger running on our line, but they're under our contract.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, Mayor Cognetti, you are not a native of northeastern Pennsylvania, but it wasn't long after you settled here that you heard about this prospect. Is that correct?
Right. My mother-in-law used to go shopping with her sisters in the city, and you heard about it. You heard about the efforts to do it. My father-in-law was like, oh, you know, I don't know if it'll ever happen again, but they've talked about it. And to Secretary Carroll's point, to Larry's point, this is transformational funding that we have right now. There's an opportunity with President Biden's bipartisan infrastructure law to actually get this done. The hurdles that Larry laid out, the hard work that he has put in for decades, have set the stage for this to be successful. And it's hard to overstate what an exciting opportunity this is for Scranton.
You know, over the 20th century, train travel had diminished. So there are probably a lot of northeastern Pennsylvania residents that never really rode a true passenger train. Who here has ridden a passenger train? Okay. Can you explain the difference experience from a passenger train to riding from here to Scranton in a bus?
The bus service is great and it's a wonderful asset, but trains, I used to live in Washington, D.C. I would often take the regional up to Philadelphia or New York or even Boston. It's just a larger space. You're able to spread out a bit more. You can use the restroom as you like. There's a dining car. It's a lot easier to get business done, be able to travel as a group and have fun with your friends.
Yes.
If I may, the quality of travel experience on this type of Amtrak corridor train that we're going to have is just a whole different level. I mean, you're able to get up and, as the mayor said, walk around, stretch your legs. Right. Much more importantly, you're able to have food service, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, full beverage service on these trains, Wi-Fi equipped. It's an extension of your office. It's a whole different quality of life.
And Congressman Cartwright, how about you? How do you like train service and train travel?
No, my comrades could not have stated it better. It's a superior way to travel. You can work on a train. You have Wi-Fi. You have a restaurant car. You can move around, go to the bathroom. Right. It's a delightful way to travel. And my position is this, and it has been since Larry and his posse landed on me. Larry Malski and Bob Hay and Dominic Keating, and even before I got elected, 2012, they brought home to me that this is an opportunity. It's a long shot, but if we work on it and we stay steadfast and we don't take our eye off the ball, we could make this happen. And you know what? The bottom line is Northeastern Pennsylvania people are entitled to the very best. And it's up to us to make sure that they get it.
Mm-hmm. So $66 billion was a game changer from the infrastructure bill. Now, this Scranton cutoff obviously is just a portion of that. Do we have that figure at hand, what it's actually going to cost in
we
that?
We thought, Larry, of course, we refer to the bipartisan infrastructure law, and that became the IIJA, the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act. And when I found out that it was actually Senator Schumer who was writing that bill, we thought it was being written in the House, found out at a late date that it was Senator Schumer's bill. I got a Zoom call with him, and I asked him simply, add another $2 billion to the new rail starts. So instead of 64, it was $66 billion. Doesn't mean we get it, but it improves our chances. And it brought home to Senator Schumer that this is a possibility. What has really made this a success and what has brought us to the point where we're having a show like this to talk about the likelihood of it happening is that we have a broad coalition of civic leaders who are all on board, so to speak, all in favor of this project because they realize how transformational it can be for our area. In fact, after it was announced that we made it in December, we made it into the Corridor ID program. We had an announcement, and I had all the mayors up. We had the mayor of East Stroudsburg, Mayor Brzezowski, Mayor Moreno from Stroudsburg, Mayor Cognetti from Scranton, Mayor Brown from Wilkes-Barre, Mayor Cassatt from Hazleton, Mayor Lombardo from Pittston, people from different parties, and of course all the state representatives on both parties, and all kinds of stakeholders in our community have come together and brought home the importance of this project. And really, when Josh Shapiro, I talked to him 2 weeks into his term, I had a long call with him, and he said, Matt, I'm in. This is exactly what government is supposed to do.
And how often does that happen in our political spectrum today? Well, Congressman, your friend in the Senate, Bob Casey, has also been an advocate for the project, and we asked him for his comments. Here's what he had to say.
Whether it's Lackawanna County or Luzerne County, but all the counties in our region, for years, many people have been making that commute to New York City. And obviously, the only way really now to do that is by bus. So I guess some could drive, but to have the opportunity to get on a train every morning, get to work and get home in a manner that's convenient and safe. I mean, one of the best features of a train is you can do work on a train. I mean, if you want to relax, that's something you can also do. But a lot of people work on the train in ways that you cannot do. Just consider the productivity that people can achieve because they have that time to read and to work on the train, to get ready for work or to do some work on the way home. So that's another huge benefit, just productivity for travelers.
That was Senator Bob Casey. And just a reminder that we are live streaming this program on Facebook and YouTube. And after the TV broadcast ends at 7:30, we'll continue with a Q&A online. So get your questions ready for our panel. Mayor Cognetti, now, this connection between the Electric City and the Big Apple, what are the benefits to the residents of the greater Scranton area?
So there's benefits all along the entire corridor, not just in Scranton. You think about families that can be more flexible in moving from a high-cost area of, say, northern New Jersey to a place like Scranton. Retirees who might want to leave the New York, New Jersey, Connecticut area and come to Pennsylvania where their retirement income isn't taxed. You have entrepreneurs who can't afford the overhead of building a business in Brooklyn. They could come down to downtown Scranton, live downtown, don't need a car. They can still hop on the train, get to those investor meetings once, twice a week. You have the universities, not just in Scranton, but through our whole region, mm-hmm. that could see an influx of students from those locations. And, you know, students from Scranton, from Wilkes-Barre, from our whole area that would be able to maybe access those other universities and those trade schools in other areas more easily. And, of course, the tourism piece. We've got Montage, you know, people skiing on Montage, right, as we we speak, just 10 minutes from here. There's so much activity, there's so many recreational opportunities right here that people could access.
Have you heard a lot of positive comments, mostly positive comments about?
Mostly positive.
Mostly
you always
positive?
Have a few naysayers, but it's vastly positive.
Well, we have a couple that have come in via social media, and we've addressed this one. It says, you know, Larry, nobody loves you guys more, I guess, talking about WVIA. Mm-hmm. But we've been hearing about this for 30 years, and, you know, that was from Kathy on Facebook. And Bob on Facebook, could it be several years away when hearing about it? So we have established, I think, that we're as sure as anything can be in this sort of arena that this is going to happen. But you can never be 100% sure until that first person gets on board, I guess. But here's one. You think the drug and crime problem in northeastern Pennsylvania is bad now? Just wait and see how bad it's about to get, says Brandon. And we also heard from Jerry. Yay, a new way to get drugs into northeastern PA. Yippee. A little sarcasm there. Well, how do you answer that, Larry?
Yeah, I'll be happy to answer that. I am a frequent Amtrak rider, so I've traveled around the country on corridor trains and the long-distance trains and the entire northeast corridor. The intro to your show tonight was Moynihan Station in New York City. And as I ride through that center, which connects to anywhere in the country, this train out of Scranton will allow you to go to 500 different Amtrak destinations across the U.S. and Canada. But that station, you see the officers there, you see the drug-sniffing dogs, you see the plainclothesmen, you see the all of the other entities, federal, state, and local, from a police position. Mm-hmm. It makes no sense to think that this is going to be some conduit for drugs. Mm-hmm. It's probably the least likely means of doing that type of nefarious situation.
Mm-hmm. And Mayor, do you have a follow-up to that? Do you have a comment?
Yeah, I'd say we look at our highway system. We know that, you know, drugs come here through mostly cars, and we have incredible law enforcement at the local level, at the cities, our county, the state level with PSP, with the federal agents, with DEA. All of those law enforcement entities work very, very well together. We've seen that in real time in the Scranton area in these last few weeks. So that is already in place. But the best way to combat gang activity, drug activity, is to have economic opportunity. The more economic opportunity we have, the better. So we open this up with a train line. We have people that are able to have, you know, a parent that makes a New York City salary but lives in Scranton or the surrounding area. That's opportunity, right? Having more people be able to come and go, businesses that come here because of the low overhead costs and build up jobs right here in Scranton and Lackawanna County and northeastern Pennsylvania. That's the way to fight that, in addition to our incredible law enforcement fabric that we already have laid down.
So Larry, what more needs to be done before that first passenger gets aboard?
Well, as Secretary Carroll mentioned, you know, we've been accepted into the federal program. Some have been and some have not been. We're fortunate to be one that has. We now are working. We've got a great team together with PennDOT, with MyRail, with the Regional Rail Authority, with New Jersey Transit, and with Amtrak. And these are the entities that are going to put this thing together, but we've now got an ability to fund it with federal funds. And the federal funds are key, because that's really what this is. It's a federal entity, and that's what was holding it up for these 30 or 40 years that you keep hearing about.
Secretary Carroll?
And it's important to note that Governor Shapiro and PennDOT are all in with respect to passenger rail here in northeastern Pennsylvania. As this progresses through the FRA process, there'll be a requirement for some matching funds to pair with the federal funds, and the governor and PennDOT are prepared to be that partner to advance this project. It's worth noting that we have passenger rail initiatives underway from Reading to Philadelphia and an expanded service from Harrisburg to Pittsburgh, all because of the FRA and the bipartisan infrastructure bill. So there's a partnership that's necessary here from the Commonwealth, and we look forward to being that wonderful partner.
Mm-hmm. I want to get into how the operation is going to continue to thrive going forward. But I just want to remind viewers that time is running out very quickly. And so if you have a comment or question, please do submit that now. And that afterwards, we're streaming this live on Facebook and YouTube. And so you can join us for some Q&A once this TV broadcast ends in about 7 minutes. So let's get back to what is PennDOT's role going forward as the, say the train is up, it's 2028, it's running everywhere all on, and it's now 28, 29, 30. What is the role that PennDOT plays in that?
Well, we have a significant role before we get to the first train, Larry. Mm-hmm. It's worth noting that, the authority and PennDOT and the FRA and Amtrak have to bring this to fruition. Mm-hmm. And so in so many ways, PennDOT and our consultant partners will help advance the various documents that will flow to the FRA to advance this project to completion. And there will be a financial support necessary mm-hmm. With respect to the matching funds as this advances.
We have a question from the audience. Please state your name, where you're from, and then proceed to your question.
My name is Eric Sigland. I'm the mayor of Eastside Borough in Carbon County. And I'm a big supporter of this because I work for a company that has an office in New York, and I currently go to New York once a month to go work out of the office, but currently have to drive to Dover, New Jersey to catch the train. So I would be much happier to catch the train in Mount Pocono.
Mm-hmm.
How
long a trip would that be for you now?
It's an hour, a little over an hour to drive from my house in Eastside to Dover, New Jersey, and then about an hour and 10 minutes on the train mm-hmm. from Dover to New York City. So it's about a 2.5 hour commute one way if I drive and mm-hmm. take the train.
And will this save you time though?
This would save me time because then I only have to drive 20 miles up the road as opposed to an hour up the road.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So Mayor Cognetti, in Scranton, we have to establish a train station.
Mm-hmm.
So is that the responsibility of the city?
No, it doesn't lie on the city. We'll certainly work with our partners at Amtrak and okay. at the other levels of government to make sure that we've done our part for the footprint in the surrounding area. Mm-hmm. We'll be really focused not just on helping make sure that we're a good partner in that way, but working on the economic development pieces and the transit pieces that we already are working on with Secretary Carroll's team mm-hmm. to make our whole downtown, but especially that west end of our downtown, a really inviting place for people to come for tourism mm-hmm. and a place that's much more walkable. So that if you mm-hmm. live downtown or you want to park somewhere downtown, you could get there without having to park right at the mm-hmm. station. So we mm-hmm. want to make sure that everything's more walkable mm-hmm. and that'll be a really exciting addition to the entire city, to the whole region, right? You can mm-hmm. just be able to drive in right into Scranton and then get, like Larry said, to 500 destinations with Amtrak. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. It's again hard to overstate how exciting that is.
I apologize. I must have cut you off a little bit early. So you had a question?
Well, that's good because the mayor kind of led into my question. In our area, we have a lot of tourist destinations, and we have a lot of people coming and going for that part, not just people like me who would use it for commuting. So my question is, are there provisions in the plans to improve regional transit to get people to and from the train stations? Because that's the problem we have with the airport today. We don't have good regional transit, especially in the rural areas like where we are, mm-hmm. to get people to and from the train. And I'm just wondering what kind of plans are in the works for that.
I could take a stab
yes,
at that.
Sure.
And it's been discussed for years, but the new county commissioners, Lackawanna County, have put together an initial concept of bringing all the local transit providers together in an informal coalition to address the connectivity of the Amtrak service and the Amtrak corridor trains with each station. So that's actually underway now. We've talked about it over the years, but without the Amtrak corridor train, there really wasn't the genesis to do it. But we're discussing that as we speak.
Mr. Carroll?
I think Eastside is in Carbon County. And the important note here is that this is not just a Lackawanna County, mm-hmm. Monroe County proposition. Mm-hmm. This is an entire northeastern and central Pennsylvania proposition. And it'd be my expectation that there'd be a level of coordination with the various leaders in these various counties, including Carbon, mm-hmm. To make sure that there's access to the stations that happen to be closest. We're a little bit away from that now, but that has to be in the mix.
I would think that this would encourage, say, bus companies and the like to put in more lines, more in the schedule, just to have that. Wouldn't you think that would encourage them to do that?
Right. Often in conversations, people from Wilkes-Barre or students at Wilkes and King's will say, well, you know, what about us? And I'm not going to say that we're going to be able to get a rail link directly from Wilkes-Barre up, but I do think that there will be money to be made from more bus service and more mass transit between cities like Wilkes-Barre and throughout the entire region.
Now, Larry, you've been working on this for decades and making sure all those rail lines are acquired and preserved and persuading many of the benefits of this. So this must be a dream come true for you.
It is, but it goes to one of my guiding principles, which is perseverance, and that's what it takes to save these rail corridors, and it takes a lot of time, too, and money. And finally, we have that last piece, which is the federal portion, which we never had over the last 30 years.
And that's the game changer, right? This money, the $66 billion. We didn't establish about how much that it's going to cost for this. What we're setting aside, what portion of that $66 billion? I think I saw a figure of $80 million or something like that. It seems like that's
it'll
just,
be far
it'll have to be
far
much more than that.
It must be far in excess.
It'll be more than that.
Yeah.
Far in excess.
Yeah.
We're talking about probably somewhere between $800 million and maybe $1.2 billion, which is why I talked to Senator Schumer about that. But I will tell you this, Larry, I would be remiss if I didn't bring home the point that Secretary Mike Carroll and Governor Josh Shapiro, them throwing themselves into this project, you could have all the federal money in the world you want. 80% of it is picked up by the federal government. But if you don't have the local match, you're out to lunch.
Right.
And if it weren't for Mike Carroll and Josh Shapiro, it would have been the Matt and Larry application to the Federal Railroad Administration, and that wasn't going to get very far.
Congressman, we'll have to leave it there right now for the TV broadcast, but the conversation continues with our live streams on Facebook and YouTube. Our panel is answering your questions and comments directly from our live stream, so find us on Facebook and YouTube. And right now, I would like to thank our panelists for participating, and thank you for joining us. For more information, you can go to wvia.org/keystonereports. I'm Larry Voitko. Thanks so much for watching.